here today. Gold Coast holds a really special place in my journey towards platforms. 5 years back, I was, literally 5 years back, July of 2012, I was holidaying with my wife in North Stradbroke Island, which is not really on the international map of holiday destinations, but we kind of, we stumbled upon it. We spent a week there in a cottage, and a lot of ideas had been brewing around in my head for quite some time, and it was right there, away from the hustle and bustle of Singapore, that I decided that I wanted to focus on figuring out what platforms are and why they're important. And so that's the journey that started in the Gold Coast 5 years back, and so it's great to be back here to talk about my work on platforms that I've been building over this period of time. So over the past several years, I've been looking at understanding how a confluence of digital technologies are coming together to fundamentally transform not just business models, but more importantly, market structures, and how business models sit within market structures, how power within market structures changes, how the choke points, the control points that companies have get eroded, and how new control points or new moats get created for companies to compete in this new market structure. And so over this period, I wrote two best-selling books which capture a lot of my work in this area. And I want to talk about some of the ideas that I shared over there, as well as some of the research I've done ever since, and some of the work that I've been seeing as I work with companies implementing these ideas. So when we talk about transformation today, we understand that transformation is imperative. It's something that every organization feels the need for, and every organization is investing in. But we don't often think through the anatomy or the structure of transformation. Very often, transformation in organizations looks like this. It looks like a series of scattered experiments. Typically, what happens is there's an innovation team, which is strategically outside the central organization. It's given its own license to do things, to experiment, and it runs a lot of experiments trying to find the next big bet. Very often, what emerges out of it is that various point solutions get created in the overall business model. If there are certain aspects of the business today that could leverage a certain technology, that technology gets implemented in that particular aspect of the business. What a lot of these transformation stories miss is that real transformation happens through a complete re-architecture of the system. You have to completely rewire the system, completely change the way stakeholders are involved, where value is created, where value is captured. All of those things completely change. And that's what I want to talk about over the next few minutes today. To think about transformation, I want to take an example of another technology, a non-digital technology, that has had a profound impact and has shaped the world as we see it today. And that is the container. Containerization has changed the way trade works in this world. Containerization is the single innovation that has fundamentally globalized the whole world. And if you look at the transformation that happened because of containerization, it worked its way through in three phases. In the first phase, containerization standardized the movement of goods around the world. In the past, if you had to move things from one place to the other, the way you would move a bale of cotton would be very different from the way you would move, say, a metal. But with containerization, all of that changed. Containers created a standardized model by which goods could be transported around the world. As a result of this, the first step of transformation that came in was in the form of improved efficiencies. The first layer of value that was created was just more of the same, better of the same. So ports started behaving much more efficiently. The turnaround time for container ships at ports became much shorter. Ships got utilized much better. Logistics systems got utilized much better. So the first range of impact was all about efficiency. Once that came in, usually this first step is extremely important, because without this initial business case, a new system does not get implemented. And this initial business case, because there was immediate impact on the turnaround time and on the utilization capacity, this was implemented, and containerization started changing the way the world worked. And that led to the second phase of change, which was about seeing economies and seeing a fundamental evolution, a fundamental redesign of various components of the system. So ships got redesigned, because now that they were containers, ships were designed to optimize for storage of containers. Logistic systems got redesigned, the processes that moved these containers, the kinds of machines that were there at various ports that lifted and moved these containers, all of those things got redesigned. So the entire logistics operations got redesigned. And finally, that's what led to the real change that we saw all around the world. For the first time, we saw the architecture of global supply chains, which worked much more efficiently very often than local supply chains, where you could leverage economies of scale across the globe because the cost of moving things was that much smaller and the efficiency of moving things was that much higher. And all of this happened because of something very simple and fundamental about the container. The container standardized the movement of goods. When you standardize something, you enable coordination of multiple participants around this new standard. Without standardization, it becomes very difficult for coordination to happen. And because there is no coordination, you start seeing inefficiencies, because you start seeing the creation of silos that do not talk to each other. Global supply chains were created because containers created the standards for logistics systems, for shipping systems, for all of these things to talk to each other and goods to be delivered end-to-end from the source to the destination. That's what led to the eventual transformation of global supply chains, of supply chains towards these global entities. And so what we see with that example is that transformation takes place in these three steps. You need the efficiency part of it, because that is what helps you change the building blocks of the system. People would not have moved to containers if there was not an immediate business case over there. But once you've done that, and once you start seeing those efficiencies, the change in efficiencies, the next set of value gets created when you start looking for entirely new business models and entirely new designs that exploit these new efficiencies. So the assumptions have changed, and now you start redesigning systems around those assumptions. And once you've done that, when this becomes the standard for your industry, that is when you can start using this as a coordination mechanism to start benefiting from externalities. And that's what we saw with the container revolution. Today, we're seeing that in a much bigger way with what I think of as the platform revolution, but more broadly with digitization in general. If you look at what digitization does, digitization creates a standard for the coordination of multiple participants by taking a market actor or a market action and an action or an interaction between participants, digitizing it, digitizing the intent behind it, digitizing the actual action, and then coordinating the market around this digitized action. So let's take a few examples. In the past, buyer behavior was captured in silos. If you went to a shop, your buyer behavior would be captured on the sales receipt, and maybe it would be captured and it would sit somewhere in a database that would not talk to the rest of the world. What Amazon and Netflix did was they digitized the buyer behavior for the first time. Think of it as similar to the container example I just gave. Because your buyer behavior got digitized, it could move around. It could move around within Amazon, it could move around to partners of Amazon, it could move around in the system, and different participants could use this standardized implementation, the standardized expression of buyer behavior to create new business models. As a result of which, the first few kinds of evolution that we saw with the digitization of buyer behavior was the rise of personalization. We started seeing retailers like Amazon and Netflix encouraging entirely new interactions that would not have happened in the past, because that data about buyer behavior was not being captured. A little further down the line, with the rise of the social web, we saw the digitization of identity. Before Facebook, before the rise of the social web, the internet was a place filled with anonymous people, and so it was very difficult to trust someone on the internet. Everything that we see today in the form of the sharing economy, in the form of real-world transactions actually happening between people, have been enabled because identity got digitized, as a result of which, trust got digitized. first the identity got digitized, and then specific vertical trust parameters were created. Could you stay at somebody's place? Airbnb created a specific trust parameter for that. Could you get into somebody's car? Uber created a specific trust parameter for that. And again, what we see is that when this critical market interaction parameter, the most critical parameter over here, the decision on whether you would want to stay with somebody, the critical parameter of trust, the moment that got digitized, you started seeing entirely new interactions happening. Again, you started seeing externalities coming up. Further down the line, with the smartphone revolution, with the widespread adoption of smartphones, location got digitized. Now your car could be a digital object. In the past, your car was not a digital object, which is why when Zipcar first launched, they failed to get traction. But when Uber launched, when Lyft launched, they got traction really fast because they could use the car as a digitized object. They could use data about where cars were moving around, traffic patterns, what was happening all over the city, and all of that helped them move this market towards entirely new interactions. So again, we see this pattern repeated commonly every time digitization hits a certain market. In a vein very similar to what happened with containerization, what digitization does is it standardizes a specific parameter in the market interaction, and once that parameter gets standardized, it allows a whole range of external participants to come in and interact around that parameter. Given that a car's location is digitized, as a consumer, I can start interacting with that car through the Uber application. We've seen this happen with the rise of labor platforms as well. Reputation got digitized, and so clients can now look for freelancers, companies can extend their labor force on the cloud, all of which happened because reputation got digitized. And finally, in heavy industry, we're starting to see machine performance getting digitized, where you can determine how well a certain machine is behaving, and on the basis of that, you can create a whole new range of services, whether it is in terms of monetizing the uptime of the machine or maintaining the machine before the machine even fails. All of these things are possible because a new form of digitization has entered a particular market. So what we see across all of this is that digitization standardizes a specific parameter around which new market interactions can now start happening, because of which we are now seeing a fundamental shift in the shape of business. And this is what I talk about in my work on platforms. Traditionally, we had thought of business, the way business worked in the industrial model was a very linear model of business, which I think of as a pipeline, where value is created upstream and it moves downstream. And as value moves down this, an item moves down this pipeline, it keeps gathering more value until at the end it meets a customer who pays money in exchange for this value, and that's how the business worked end to end. All of the pipeline was closely coordinated and managed usually by one company, and any other companies who would participate on the basis of very strong contracts. So it was a very closely managed end-to-end chain. What we're now seeing, because of digitization and because of the fact that digitization allows the coordination of multiple participants around a central business, is that we're seeing a new design of business, which is the platform design of business, where instead of seeing things in a straight line, what the firm does in the case of a platform is it creates an infrastructure over which external market participants, producers and consumers come on board and start interacting with each other. In order for this interaction to happen, it's important that the platform owner digitizes and owns the most critical market variable. So if it's a healthcare platform, the platform owner needs to own the patient data. That is what will bring other third parties on board so that the two can start interacting. We've seen many examples of platforms in the world of startups. We've seen Facebook, Google, Apple, and PayPal, a lot of the first generation platforms that have grown really big. We've seen Uber, Airbnb, and many other platforms of late which have grown really big. But what's really exciting is that this design of business is now becoming increasingly and even more relevant to traditional pipeline businesses who can exploit this single idea of digitizing something within their business and creating an ecosystem of external participants around that digitized variable. So when we think of the idea of a platform, fundamentally, a platform has two components. It has an infrastructure, it provides an infrastructure over which an external market comes on board and starts interacting. So a platform is essentially interactions enabled by infrastructure, which essentially implies that a platform needs to think about two things in particular. First, a platform should have an open architecture. If you do not have an open architecture, you cannot have external participants participate on the platform. And so the platform needs to have a mechanism by which it can allow external participants to come on board and connect onto the platform. Today, this idea of openness, of connecting onto a platform, is very intuitive because of how digital technology in general connect us. But what's important over here is that whenever you're building something with an open architecture, you need to ask yourself, what am I opening and what am I keeping closed? Because every time you open something, your control point shifts. You need to have a new control point so that you can continue governing the system, which is where the second thing becomes important. With every open architecture, you need to have a mechanism to govern that particular architecture. You need to have a mechanism which determines who can get in, what are the factors that determine what kind of influence they have on the platform, how do you determine whether somebody is a trustworthy person or a trustworthy party versus not. How do you determine whether a certain recommendation is relevant or not? What are the kinds of user journeys you lead them through so that they get increasing value over time from the platform? All of these factors come into the governance of the platform. And without the right governance, any platform model can collapse. We've seen this repeatedly where you take the example of a platform like Chatroulette, which was started by a Russian teenager, which anonymously allowed anyone to connect with anyone and start a video chat. And so you know what happened. Because it was anonymous and because it was video, pretty soon it descended into a place where there were a lot of men who were not wearing many clothes. And everybody else who was not part of that category started leaving the platform until eventually the only people left were these guys. And so that platform did not go anywhere because they had open architecture, they had really open architecture, but they did not have any governance. So it's really important that when you're running a platform, you have to open it out for the ecosystem, for your external producers and consumers to come on board. But it's extremely important that every time you open something up, you figure out what is the new governance mechanisms we put in. And this is especially important for incumbents because this is something that may come naturally for an Instagram or the Snapchat. They may not even call this openness or governance. But you have a closed business model with which you've been making money over the last 100 years, and suddenly you start hearing all this talk about openness. It's important to understand that every time you open your platform, you need to rejig your whole governance mechanisms as well. So when we now look at the same framework that we used to understand containers, if we take that same framework and apply it to platforms, typically platform transformation happens in 3 steps. The first step, as with the container example, is one where you benefit from efficiencies and you need this short-term business case so that you can digitize the key assets that constitute your business model. As an example, if you think of the retail industry had a very clear business case for digitization because users would come offline into the shops and browse around, and then they would go online and buy things somewhere else. And so there was a clear need for retailers to start digitizing user interactions in the store so that they could then follow the user online and target him over there. So you need to start with a short-term business case where digitization creates immediate efficiencies. It helps you gain lost revenue, it helps you make more of the same revenue, but it needs to start with an efficiency business case. What happens after that is once you start digitizing the user interactions with the business's assets and resources, you come to a point where you can start benefiting from economies and potentially even evolve the business model. So again, if you take the retailer example, because user interactions were getting digitized, on the other side, they also had to digitize how their assets were moving within the stores. And when they started digitizing that, they started ensuring that suppliers who were supplying to them were also participating on the central digital infrastructure. And so they now could track and trace assets across their whole supply chain. And that led to the benefits of economy, of connecting everything together. Eventually, what happens is that once you've digitized this, once you've connected all of your enterprise, once you have a single view of the customer, you are at a point where you can start harnessing the external ecosystem. Because you need to be at a, you need to have, as a firm, you need to have a single view of external participants before you can start creating a business model that involves interactions between external participants. The reason a lot of companies fail but when they try to copy Uber or Airbnb or any of these platforms is that they don't think about it in this phased out manner. First of all, if you straight away go from saying, we used to sell this product, now we want to be the Uber of our industry, there is no business case in the short term, there is probably a pipe dream in the long run, but there is no clear roadmap towards a new architecture. And what I've seen repeatedly, when companies do this well, they always follow this roadmap that takes them down this journey. The second thing that this shows and demonstrates is that unless you have a single view of the ecosystem across the organization, you cannot credibly orchestrate an external ecosystem. What a lot of companies do, especially telcos, what a lot of companies do is they create a separate business unit that tries to act like a platform, but the rest of the business does not talk to it. And because of that, there is no central view of the ecosystem, and the advantage that you have of leveraging your incumbent knowledge of your partners, of your customers, is lost, because the incumbent business lines do not have a single view of the ecosystem. And that is why this phased approach and the end idea of creating an architecture of transformation becomes really important when we think about digitization and the impact on the business. So with that, let's talk about what makes platform business models so successful. The first thing that I've already mentioned is the idea of openness. Platforms open themselves out to external participation, and so they are not limited by the resources they have internally. They're able to dip into resources in the ecosystem and leverage those resources. As a result of this, platforms start benefiting from network effects, where more producers coming on board make the platform more valuable because of the resources they bring on board. That attracts consumers from the other side, and more consumers coming on board make the platform more valuable because for a producer, this becomes a good channel to market. And so if you look at all of the examples of successful platforms today, whether it is startups like Airbnb or incumbents like GE, in all these cases, we see the rise, the creation of network effects as the single point at which the platform becomes defensible and starts winning over its competitors. What happens at that point is, as more producers come on board, more consumers want to come on the platform. As more consumers come on board, more producers want to come on the platform. And eventually, you have this kind of a winner-take-all where any other platform that comes in does not succeed in attracting the ecosystem with the same level of intensity, because all of the ecosystem is coalescing around this existing platform. As I mentioned earlier, when you start seeing an ecosystem growing, you need to govern the ecosystem. And governance is typically about asking two questions. What is the incentive for participation, and who can participate, and how? What kind of rights and influence do they have on the platform? More importantly, all of this is achieved through carefully architecting feedback loops. Feedback loops could be at the level of an individual participant, it could be at the level of a system. At the level of an individual participant, it could be something as simple as you getting a notification on Facebook when your friend posts something on Facebook. So that feedback mechanism brings you back, and then your activity brings that person back as well. At the level of a system, a feedback mechanism may work in many different ways. As a platform like Uber, for example, starts benefiting from starts seeing more rides taking place in a particular city, it starts observing patterns about how rides are hailed at various points in the city, at various points in time during the day. And it can then use those patterns to orchestrate the ecosystem towards various parts of the city based on what the data predicts. So that's an example of a system-level feedback loop. So what drives the platform is carefully architecting all of these feedback loops. What we missed in a traditional pipeline model was because of a lack of connectivity, we could not create these real-time feedback loops. Pipelines had a very long lag in their feedback loop, and that prevented a lot of different things from happening, all of which can be enabled on a platform business model. And finally, what we've seen today is that a few platforms are gathering a lot of data, they're learning from this data, and they are becoming increasingly powerful because of all of this data coalescing around these few central platforms. So when we take all of these ideas and take it back to incumbents and look at how what this looks like when incumbents transform, when traditional industries move in the direction of platforms, we again see a few key themes that get repeated from time to time. And these themes are not just patterns picked from case studies. These are structural themes. These are themes that are structurally an outcome of what a platform is. The first theme that we see with any company which is downstream in the value chain is that companies, firms are moving from product centricity to user centricity. In the past, these firms would have competed on the basis of product excellence, on the basis of operational excellence. What happens when the world gets connected is that distribution no longer remains a competitive advantage because everybody has access to the same distribution to some extent. And so the competitive advantage shifts from access to distribution to access to user engagement. And the few companies that can exploit this user engagement emerge as the most successful companies in their respective industries. We see this happen in the media industry. The media industry was traditionally and still is a very product-centric industry. And that is why the most powerful person in any media organization is typically the editor, because it was all about editorial quality. What happened with the rise of the internet was the power shifted away from access to distribution to access to user engagement. And so Facebook and Google became powerful, even though they did not have the same level of editorial capabilities and actually leveraged content from the ecosystem. So we understand this intuitively in how it applies to media, but this is happening across other industries as well. Retail is shifting to a user-centric model. Healthcare is increasingly shifting to a user-centric model, where eventually, in the long run, the few companies that understand the patient really well will win the game and will become the center control points for that entire industry. So if you look at healthcare as an example right now, a whole range of companies are zeroing in to digitize and capture that user data. You have the traditional hospitals coming in with their electronic health records, digitizing the patient's activity. You have new healthcare companies, wearable companies coming in like Fitbit and Jawbone, and they're digitizing wellness data while hospitals digitize cure and intervention data. You have pharmacies like Walgreens coming in and digitizing the purchase of pills, which also gives a pretty good, comprehensive picture of a patient's profile, especially if the patient has a chronic condition, because the patient continues to buy pills, and so you can make you can make a very good approximation of what their profile is. And then you have healthcare companies, you have consumer electronic companies like Philips coming in and trying to digitize the test data. You have companies like Apple and Google also coming in after this particular data. So what we're seeing is that in an industry like healthcare, you've got all of these different companies coming in from different industries, all of them after one particular data point, which is the patient's health profile. Because whoever owns that owns the control point on the ecosystem. The same thing is happening in the automotive industry as well. It's happening in the banking and financial services industry as well. And what this repeatedly shows that when you stop thinking in terms of products and move to start thinking in terms of user data, your traditional industrial boundaries do not remain the same. Because your traditional industrial boundaries were based on the kinds of products you sold, whereas now it depends on what kind of user data do you capture. So companies from any industry can come in and start competing with you. Insurance companies today, for example, are a separate shift, which is that companies today no longer need to rely only on their organizational resources, on their internal resources. They can leverage the ecosystem resources. And this is especially important because when you become user-centric, you realize that you cannot solve all the problems of the user yourself. You can only do what you always did well, because that is what your organization enables you to do. And so if you want to solve all the problems of the user, you need to leverage an ecosystem of partners, which is why the two kind of work hand in hand. There's a feedback loop. The more user-centric you become, the more you need to leverage your ecosystem advantage and bring partners into the mix. Which leads us to a third point, that platforms are converting opaque markets into transparent markets. We saw this happen in consumer markets. So think of TripAdvisor. In the past, the hotel booking market was very opaque. If you were not going to a well-branded hotel, you did not really know what to expect. But TripAdvisor created a reputation model that acts as the decision criteria for you every time you travel. It helps you determine where to stay. And so a whole opaque market was made transparent. The reason this is important for incumbents is if incumbents are to use ecosystem, are to shift from the organizational advantage to the ecosystem advantage, they need to know who to partner with, who is worth partnering with, and who to trust in their ecosystem. And this is what we're seeing now in B2B ecosystems as well. We're seeing the creation of reputation in B2B ecosystems. In the past, B2B transactions, B2B relationships worked on the basis of contracts. And because it was too difficult to find and evaluate a new partner, you would often continue working with the same old partner. But as more and more industries start benefiting, start getting this reputation data about their particular ecosystem of partners, the players in those industries can increasingly start going out and forming new relationships. What changes in a B2B case scenario though is that you won't have social feedback to determine reputation. You won't have businesses rating other businesses. Instead, you will determine reputation on the basis of actual digitized interaction. Whether that interaction is happening over a supplier sourcing portal or whether it is happening over an invoicing application. Every time you use a software application to interact with another business, you're giving data to the platform to help it determine your reputation as a company on a particular parameter. All of which will determine partnerships in the future. Now once these two things happen, once user centricity works with ecosystem advantage, companies start moving from monetizing promises to monetizing performance and commitment. In the past, what companies would sell was a promise. Every time you sold a product, you were selling a promise. And if the product would work well, the promise would be fulfilled. But today what's happening is companies are increasingly moving away from selling these promises and actually moving to selling commitment and performance. A very well documented example of this is Rolls-Royce and the way it sells jet engines to Boeing and Airbus. In the past, it used to sell the jet engine, which was heavy investment, a significant investment, and what's happening today is now it's shifted its business model so that it's charging the customers for actual flight time rather than for the engine itself. Now what happens because of that is the moment one company does that in a particular industry, all customers start moving in that direction because the economics work that much better. As customers start moving in that direction, that one company starts getting a really good stranglehold over all of that customer's data. And as that company starts getting more information about the customers, it can become the central point around which all the other partners start aligning. So when you start seeing this happening in a particular industry, you can predict that very soon there's going to be a consolidation in that industry where a few companies will start building platforms and start serving the end customer and others will start serving these platforms instead. As I mentioned earlier, what's happening because of user centricity is that you're not just selling point solutions, you're not just selling what you used to, you're trying to create an end-to-end service for the user. A very good example of this is Walgreens that I mentioned some time back. So Walgreens figured out that every time users purchase medicines from their store, they were giving them data, and so it first of all it instituted a loyalty program. Think of it as the efficiencies layer. It instituted a loyalty program, not just so that you could make more money through more loyal customers, but also because through loyalty, Walgreens now had really good data profile about users. And it figured that users who had long-term chronic ailments gave organs enough data to determine what their exact profile was, where they were in their journey with that ailment, and what kinds of services they would be in need of. And then using this data, Walgreens has now created a third-party ecosystem where third-party healthcare providers come onto the platform and they target these customers. So that's an example of a company moving away from offering just a point solution, just selling a pill, to creating this ecosystem and potentially providing an end-to-end solution. And increasingly, as companies start capturing that consumer data, that digitized consumer data, we'll start seeing more companies moving from point solutions to trying to provide end-to-end solutions. The final thing that's happening with the platform revolution is that we are increasingly moving away from what I would think of as discrete business models to continuous business models. What I mean by that is in the industrial age, we've built a lot of different businesses where we have just a few user touch points and we don't have any engagement in the app. A classic example is insurance. You meet the customer when you want to get the premium, and then you meet the customer when something wrong happens. There's no engagement in between. Events are another example. There's no engagement in between the events. Education is another example. Healthcare is another such example. There's no engagement when the patient is well. The engagement happens when something goes wrong. What we are starting to see in all of these industries is that because of a continuous stream of data, because of the fact that you can continually have data from users, businesses are moving away from these discrete business models to continuous business models. So healthcare is increasingly moving to a patient-centric model where you focus more on wellness than cure, and because you focus on wellness, you can prevent the actual need for cure in the first place. Insurance again is moving to an industry where to a model where it's focusing less on trying to monetize the bad event happening and focusing more on creating new value by preventing that event from happening in the first place. Education, with all of this talk about lifelong learning, is also now seeing a lot of activity in the space where different players want to capture the end student's data so that they can serve that student across a much larger life cycle. So in all of these cases, what we see is that connectivity and the fact that you can have this ecosystem of participants allows you to start serving consumers, not just at discrete events, but in the gap as well. So all of this is great. This is what's happening with platforms across different industries. This is how platforms are changing the way incumbents work. But there's a dark side to the platform revolution as well. And that is the reason for the dark side is because what we've created, the beast that we've created in the platform revolution, is we've created these large companies that benefit from open architecture, from decentralized production, but they continue to also benefit from centralized governance. As a result of which, what happens is the central platform shifts the risk of ownership, owning the resources and providing the services to the edges of the ecosystem, but amasses all of the profit centrally. This is what happens in the case of any platform today. If you think of Uber, Airbnb, a lot of the risk gets moved to the corner and the profits get moved to the center. As a result of this, what happens is platforms may often create conflict of interest where they may start out in a manner where they invite the whole ecosystem and they start encouraging the ecosystem to interact with each other, and as they start seeing the data of these actual interactions, the platform owner themselves may start participating in the ecosystem. We've seen this example. This happened with Amazon, where Amazon continuously analyzes the way merchants are performing on the platform, and if there are specific products that are selling really well, which Amazon does not sell today, but which work very well with Amazon's Prime program, Amazon tries to get into production and acquires production facilities for those products as well, and organically pushes the merchant out. So that's an example of a dark pattern where Amazon benefits from the open architecture, open production, moving the risks out to the partner, but then there's a conflict of interest when they come in and start competing with these merchants. Platforms also bait and switch. They may start out with certain kinds of policies, partners may come on board, and they may start building their businesses on the basis of these policies, and one fine day the platform may change these policies completely. This has happened repeatedly with developer ecosystems, in the case of Facebook, Apple, several other companies where developers built entire businesses on these platforms and then the platform switched its policies. So again, that's an important thing to watch out for when you don't end up becoming the central platform and you don't have a choice but to participate on somebody else's platform. The third thing that happens is that platforms also start engaging in predatory practices, which is typically what you would think of as monopsony, which is that just like you have monopolistic power on the consumer side, you have monopsonistic power on the supplier side where you can squeeze the suppliers because you become the central choke point, the central control point that controls access to the market. You can start squeezing the suppliers and start creating predatory business practices. Finally, and we were talking about this over lunch today, finally platforms are leading to more inequality than they were when they actually should have led to more equality. And that happens because platforms have these feedback loops where when a few participants come on the platform and gain some reputation, the feedback loop starts working in their favor so that the rich keep getting richer. This has always worked in markets, it's worked in markets in general, but what platforms do is they make this feedback loop spin even faster. And that, essentially, what that leads to is a few participants on the platform become super successful and the others never get anywhere. So today we see this in a more innocent fashion on things like Instagram and Snapchat, where you have a few people with a lot of followers and most people do not have any followers. But this becomes a bigger problem when you start applying this to B2B scenarios, when you start thinking of say a clinical trial platform in a healthcare ecosystem where pharmaceutical companies would be sourcing clinical trials from these test centers. And if one test center gains a huge reputation, it starts benefiting from a lot of business, whereas the other test centers may never get off the ground in the first place. So it becomes really important in a B2B ecosystem to ensure that you do not have these feedback loops running unchecked and you do not have a few superstars emerging while the others do not get any business. Finally, what's happening today? Because of all of this, over the last 2 to 3 years, there's been a huge backlash against these dark practices of platforms. As a result of this, we're starting to see two kinds of things happening. First, you're starting to regulators are starting to wake up to platforms. We hear about this in the case of Uber, in the case of Airbnb, and how different cities and different countries are regulating them differently. But regulators are increasingly waking up to this, to the fact that platforms are becoming an increasingly important market intermediator. And so regulators are starting to respond to this and starting to create new laws. And what that leads us to is a more fragmented regulatory landscape. You have these large, four large markets. You have the US, you have the EU single digital market, you have India, you have China, and then you have a whole range of smaller markets. All of them are increasingly creating a highly fragmented landscape. What works in one country does not work in another country. Google is already seeing its business model suffer in the EU because it cannot train its algorithms in the EU using data outside the EU, nor can it use data from the EU to train its algorithms in other countries. And so the targeting, the ability to target advertisements is going down because of this fragmented regulatory landscape. It's leading to all kinds of other arbitrages as well. If you think of what's happening with the regulation of autonomous vehicles or closer home with the regulation of drone delivery, you have, for example, two American companies, Domino's Pizza and a drone delivery company called Flirty. Two American companies not piloting their drone delivery of pizza program in the US, but coming to New Zealand and piloting it over there. And beyond that, they're moving to Australia, they're moving to Europe, they don't have any plans of going to the US. So what we will start seeing is that this regulatory landscape will lead to these pockets of innovation, platform innovation in different places. If the US says no to autonomous vehicles and China says yes to that, you may very well have a lot of autonomous vehicle testing and autonomous vehicle launches going on in China rather than in the US. So we're in a period of regulatory arbitrage where companies will increasingly choose markets because of the regulation and because of the unique aspects of the laws in those specific markets. And finally, the last thing, the other key thing that we are seeing with with the platform revolution today is a backlash to centralized governance. We're starting to see a greater call for distributed governance. And the reason for this is that ecosystem participants, partners to a platform, all of them feel that there is too much power that a few platforms are amassing. The problem is that all of these distributed governance models are still very nascent. You have broadly two or three kinds of distributed governance models. One is a blockchain implemented model where governance, instead of being managed by one particular entity, gets managed by a whole range of entities who are coordinated by the blockchain. The other model that you have is of a platform collective where the ownership of the platform is distributed among the ecosystem. So if an example of this is a platform called Stocksy, which allows photographers to sell their photographs, and the platform is owned equally by the photographers as well. So that's an example of distributed governance as well, but all of these are still experiments. There is a clear tension today for platforms to move away from centralized governance to distributed governance, but at the same time, because a lot of platforms need network effects, they do not succeed in their initial days without network effects. A lot of these platforms tend to be backed by venture capital, and when you have something backed by venture capital, you need a model that appropriates profit centrally, otherwise it would not make a good investment. So fundamentally, we've not seen a good solution to the centralized governance problem. But these are two aspects that will increasingly determine where you invest in the platform economy going forward and what kinds of news you should watch out for. Thank you so much for listening to this. This is what I wanted to share.